American concentration camps. That's right, American. The question is, where was the concentration camp actually pioneered? Answer, in America.
And now, The Edwin Black Show. Sponsored by the books of Edwin Black, available on Amazon and at booksellers worldwide. And now here's Edwin.
Welcome to the Edwin Black Show. I'm Edwin Black, investigative journalist, historian, and author of IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, and many other books. If you like what this show is doing, tell a friend. Subscribe for access and alerts at theedwinblackshow.com. If you want to support our work or sponsor a show, get yourself to theedwinblackshow.com/support. You can help, big or small, and any such help assures our complete and utter intellectual and journalistic independence. Again, that is theedwinblackshow.com/support. We have solidarity today from many national organizations, such as the Emerson Family Foundation, the Fuel Freedom Foundation, Stand With Us, JNS, the Israeli American Council, EMET, American Association of Jewish Lawyers and Jurists, Scholars for Peace in the Middle East, ZOA Michigan, the Gross Family Center, and many others. Today's episode is sponsored without conditions by the Emerson Family Foundation, which for years has been trying to improve our world for everyone else. Today, we welcome guests from across America, including our four watch parties in the villages, Newton, Mass., Chicago, Illinois, and Tampa, Florida. Overseas, I see viewers logged on from Mexico, Australia, Brazil, Germany, Great Britain, Canada, Belgium, Israel, and other countries. If you have a question limited to today's topic, place it in Zoom's QA feature. The Edwin Black Show, along with our YouTube site, is fast growing and globally. We speak frankly and without partisanship to a fragmented world seeking better understanding of our tormented past, our present very, very tense, and a future still uncertain. Two items from this week's pre-monologue. Item one, and inspired by my friend Wes. That's Wes in the Bay Area. This week we learn of the worsening of conditions at the torture center and security prison known as the Slaughterhouse of Jericho, operated by the Palestinian Authority. The PA's Jericho prison is the heinous destination for journalists who report on PA corruption, those practicing protest, or verbalizing political speech that does not follow the Palestinian party line. The prison's main horror is not just detention without charge, but continuous torture targeting the eyes, legs, and back. Bricks and cables are used, hanging positions, and hog-tied punishments are everyday features of the Palestinian Authority's Jericho Torture Center. Sexual violence and blackmail against family are tools of the trade wielded by the PA security men. The Arab media and human rights campaigners have been trying to close this place for years. Now some courageous voices have emerged showing us just how torturous the conditions at Jericho have become. We have placed reports from Al Jazeera, Human Rights Watch, and Israel in this episode's show notes. Item two, by now, many of you have heard of the outrageous attempt by Ben and Jerry's Ice Cream in Vermont to impose food apartheid in Israel. Ben and Jerry's demanded its Israeli licensee, run by humanitarian Avi Zinger, stop selling to Jews and Arabs living in Judea and Samaria, Jewish land for centuries. The word Jew comes from Judea. The illegal demand was done in the name of the anti-Semitic boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, aka BDS, which has seized the mind of ignorant progressives, including Ben Cohn and Jerry Greenfield, the two neo-fascist hippie millionaires who forgot that our parents and grandparents died because their feet were standing in the wrong place, sitting on the wrong bench, and eventually for eating without permission. Even today, Arabs in Jerusalem persecute and inflict violence against Jews whose lips silently quiver as they contemplate God. The Jewish world and its allies in the human rights community fought back, finally got off their tuchuses and fought back. They fought back against Ben and Jerry, impervious to reason by virtue of its hate-seized pro-Palestinian board. But more decisively, it fought back against Ben and Jerry's trillionized parent company, Unilever, a multi-brand, multinational, multi-specialty conglomerate. Unilever is a heartless, soulless, commercial pterodactyl that makes money anywhere it can, including in totalitarian China, the regime that has reinvented genocide for our century, this time against the Uyghurs. An expensive boycott against Unilever and Ben and Jerry's, a great backlash spread like a fire that suddenly found its oxygen in unexpected corners and bursts of flame. The mobilized backlash ensured that numerous American states divested from Unilever. Grocery stores across international borders dumped Ben and Jerry's ice cream as part of the backlash. Good people also spurned Unilever's Lipton's tea, its Hellman's mayonnaise, its Dove soap, and many other sweet image products produced from the sweat of exploited cheap third world labor. Money is the lifeblood of corporate behemoths, and so the $1 million losses sapped Unilever and its plunging stock were starting to have an impact. This show, and myself personally, as well as you, my audience, were among the many muscles that flexed to fight this injustice out of Vermont. You will remember that last year when this news broke, we immediately broadcast an important show on the topic, featuring some of the top human rights lawyers in the community mobilized against Ben and Jerry. That episode centered both on the legal recourses and the revelatory factual history underpinning the entire controversy. You can view this episode right now with engrossing, well, not right now, after the show, with engrossing visual documentation now at theedwinblackshow.com or the Edwin Black Show channel at YouTube. Further, at theedwinblackshow.com, we set up a continually updated Ben and Jerry's boycott resource page in our show notes, centralizing the news of backlash activities, U.S. state divestment, and counter-boycott moves. Most importantly, and dwarfing all these other efforts, a historic lawsuit was filed against Unilever to reverse this Ben and Jerry's injustice. The main attorneys were civil rights champion Nathan Lewin, a frequent guest on this show, Brandeis Center President Aliza Lewin, also a frequent guest on this show, Mark Zell, one of Israel's best nationally minded litigators, again, a frequent guest on this show. They led a fuller legal team fighting against the clock as Ben and Jerry's had imposed a this year deadline for termination of the license. These lawyers endured many sleepless nights and weary hours of effort as they crafted a gem of groundbreaking jurisprudence and filed against Unilever in New Jersey, which is home to the company's U.S. headquarters, because these outstanding jurists representing the Israeli licensee wanted justice first and foremost. They undertook high-level secret negotiations with Unilever attorneys, and earlier this week we were happy to learn the news. The lawsuit and boycott are fully settled, 100% in favor of the Israeli licensee and the Jewish people. Victory. Unilever, as the parent company of Ben and Jerry's, sold the Israeli license in full to Avi Zinger, the Israeli licensee that Vermont had pressured. He is now free to bring people together in his own way with ice cream, free from the discriminatory diktats of Ben and Jerry's in Vermont. Remember, no one ever makes war, throws a stone, or shouts a curse while eating ice cream. And now for a brief 2-minute report from the man of the moment, victorious attorney Nathan Lewin. Take the screen, Nat.
Thank you, Edwin. I would remind your listeners that not only all the efforts you made with regard to fighting this terrible action by Ben and Jerry's, but actually you had, I guess, the first program after we filed our lawsuit in which you had myself and Aliza and Mark Zell on, I think it was March 10th, when the lawsuit was first filed in the federal court. So, I mean, you've been in the forefront of this battle and have certainly made sure that people would know about our litigation. I have to say, of course, Aliza spent hundreds of hours and Mark Zell spent hundreds of hours in negotiation with the lawyers for Unilever. They were motivated entirely by the fact that they were defendants in a litigation which they knew they would lose. And when the litigation continued, they then sought to work out some way of settling it. Not only was Aliza and Mark totally involved, but I have to tell you that among the clients I have had over 60 years in law practice, Avi Zinger really is one who can take the prize. He was involved very knowledgeably and very importantly throughout the entire negotiation. Aliza and Mark engaged in this negotiation with Avi Zinger personally at every step. And Avi, notwithstanding advice that he received from others, including Israeli lawyers, to maybe settle this case for a big amount of money that Unilever might pay him, he said, oh no, this is a important historic opportunity to really impose a major defeat on BDS. And he insisted throughout these negotiations that any settlement would not only be financial, would not only enable him to continue to sell Ben and Jerry's, but would have to include a defeat for BDS. And that was in the statement that Unilever made when it settled, a rejection of BDS. And it was because Avi Zinger, as I say, an ideal client, insisted on it and didn't, as we know, as practicing lawyers know, didn't say, well, I'll just settle for some major economic benefit. He knew that he stood for principle, and his victory in this case with this settlement, which resulted, as I say, not so much from other kinds of pressure, but from the litigation itself, the well-founded, correct, proper litigation in federal court, was the result of his and Aliza's and Mark Zell's and our local New Jersey counsel, Ed Dauber and Linda Harvey, all of their work to support this litigation. So I thank them and I thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And I noticed that this was an exceptional settlement, that the press release not only made clear what the resolution was, but had an affirmative rejection of the BDS movement. And thank you very much, Nat. And now for our main topic, American concentration camps. That's right, American. I've spent a half century investigating concentration camps, beginning at the end of the 60s, when as a young reporter, I first visited Dachau. This was before the second generation even knew it could exist. Since then, I've researched and written about the infamous names we all know from the Holocaust: Auschwitz, Buchenwald, Treblinka, and many lesser known portals of hell, such as Dora, Jasinovac. Historians have learned there were actually more than 11,000 major and minor concentration camps in Reich-conquered Europe. There were subcamps and satellite camps. three types of camps actually existed. Transit camps like Drancy in France, camps like Dachau in Germany, and extermination centers like Treblinka in Poland, and some combined all three, such as the massive complex at Auschwitz-Birkenau. The German word for such sites was Konzentrationslager, which literally means concentration camp. But where did these monstrous ideas come from? The practice of incarceration goes back millennia. The ancient Romans chained people in dungeon niches in the underground sewers and cisterns, such as the awful stench-ridden Mamertine prison. Romans also forced servitude by chaining men to rowing oars in a galley or to a workbench. The British established huge prison ships on the Thames River where inmates were chained, and history itself is replete with cramped slave quarters. In speaking of concentration camps, we distinguish between such camps and ordinary labor camps, such as despots established in quarries and mines. We do not include slave plantations, which were actually great work camps. We look carefully to that hateful transition of human density per square inch, inhumane treatment, food deprivation, beatings, and most importantly, the political causation or linkage. The key word is political. Before the Nazis, as far back as 1906, German colonists in Namibia, Africa, had created concentration camps and even an extermination on Shark Island, fed by shipping native men and women in via cattle car. But before that, the British in South Africa at the turn of the 19th and 20th centuries during the Boer Wars thought they could gain advantage by placing recalcitrant civilians in atrocious, highly packed concentration camps noted for their high death rates and starvation. Go back further. During the Spanish-American War period, Spain barbarically herded large masses of Cuban civilians into concentration camps as part of its Reconcentrada reconcentration program. The Cubans in those camps were systematically starved to death, deprived of food, and transformed into staggering skeletons. More than 300,000 Cubans died. The question is, where was the concentration camp actually pioneered? Answer, in America during its Civil War. Look no further than Andersonville, the Confederacy's most notorious prison camp, located in Macon County, Georgia. Precisely because the South viewed Union soldiers as so-called colored or runaway slaves, they often refused to treat them in any humane way or participate in equal exchange of prisoners. So they jammed into a featureless stockade, just four walls, a perimeter with little food or water supplied and zero sanitation, some 45,000 Union soldiers. They stored them there. An estimated 13,000 died of dysentery, diarrhea, and other diseases. Henry Wirtz, the commandant of Andersonville, was captured, sent to Washington, D.C., and became history's first war criminal to be tried. He was tried. He was executed for his crimes. Abraham Lincoln then ordered the War Department to adopt the Lieber Code of Wartime Conduct, which became the basis for all international law to follow from the Hague Regulations to the Geneva Conventions. But Andersonville was not the only Confederate camp. There were many. At Belle Island, 1,000 Union soldiers were forced into large open rooms in a food warehouse exposed to weather. Many died of exposure and starvation. The North had its own hell holes. Many of them. The worst of them was probably Camp Douglas in Chicago, now forgotten to history. Initially developed in 1861 as a northern training camp, within a year it was converted to a prisoner of war camp, experiencing a death rate of about 17%. So of the 26,000 plus interned over 4 years, about 4,000 died from execution or starvation or exposure. But the Civil War concentration camps were not the last in America. In World War I, the Wilson administration declared all German-American civilians, that is of German ancestry, to be deemed aliens who now had to register. Each of millions of individuals was reviewed for their risk, and thousands were forcibly incarcerated in four concentration camps, such as the one in Hot Springs, North Carolina. Their property was seized. Notorious Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer wrote that, quote, all aliens interned by the government are regarded as enemies and their property is treated accordingly. In World War II, Germans were again interred, as were Italians. Most notoriously, we remember the Japanese internment in concentration camps. We know the names, Manzanar and Tule Lake in California, Poston and Gila River in Arizona, and many others. It did not matter whether these individuals were partially or fully Japanese. The U.S. War Department's Colonel Carl Bendison, the man in charge, stated, quote, I am determined that if they have one drop of Japanese blood in them, they must go to the camp, close quote. Sounds like the one drop rule to me. Before reaching their concentration camps, the property of these Japanese Americans was disposed of in fire sales in loss-ridden fashion. Interim assembly centers were created where people lived for weeks and even months. And these were just nothing but fairgrounds and racetracks with no real housing attached. Two camps in Arizona were sited on Indian reservations despite the protests of tribal councils. The last Japanese internment camp closed in March 1946. The war was over already. FDR ordered the incarceration as a wartime measure, but Fred Korematsu sued, and the Supreme Court of America, upheld the crime in one of its worst decisions. By the way, what were Japanese Americans in the military doing while their relatives were being locked up? The famous Go for Broke unit was helping to break down the gates of Dachau. Here's a stamp the post office just released, recognizing the Japanese heroism. I think I will mail a letter to someone with one of these stamps. President Gerald Ford officially repealed FDR's Executive Order 9066, but only in 1976. But remember that in 1938, Carnegie Institution eugenics henchman Harry Laughlin cooked up a scheme with Connecticut Governor Wilbur Cross to go door to door in Connecticut seeking the unfit, that is the poor, the Appalachians, and those of African descent. Anyone who was non-Aryan, blonde, blue-eyed, they would all be eugenically raided, and the unfit were to be picked up and exiled to concentration camps in the Ozarks region, made domestic refugees in their own land, emulating the Third Reich at the very same moment. Once overcrowding set in, the inmates were then to be exterminated, probably by gas. This was the plan. I had a complete show about this, and it's coming to our YouTube channel soon. The project was started in Rocky Hill, but stopped when Governor Cross was defeated in the next election. Laughlin was given an honorary degree by Nazi Germany for helping them perfect the Nuremberg Laws. You can read much more about this in my best-selling and award-winning book, War Against the Weak. Can it happen here again? Movies such as The Siege with Denzel Washington suggested it could over an Islamic terrorist incident, but others suggest that if the progressive come to power with their proven ability to weaponize the government, Jews could be targeted for asset forfeiture, eminent domain processes, and coercive relocation centers. When I say others, I mean Philip Roth and his troubling alternative history of the United States. It was a great movie. And I also suggested as well, if the wrong people get into power in 2024. One may ask how I can stand up on July 4th and declare that America is still the greatest country on earth. I can, and I do, and I salute you, America, not with scotch, but with American rye. From my Glenwood Springs whiskey glass. I salute you because the world across the millennia has been both a cesspool of hate spewed by the bitch of Babylon and a heavenly merciful peace established by God and purveyed by his emissaries. And all of it has funneled down into the United States, the good and the bad, the slime and the wine. We have reformed the world awkwardly, discarded its darkest traditions, often expunging them from our own midst. The greatest proof of our efforts to make a more perfect union are in front of you. Where am I now? Am I in a Chinese torture cell, a Russian gulag, a Jordanian black site, in Iran's Evian prison? No, I am in my basement speaking freely, and no one can stop me. This country empowered me to dredge up its dark past in order to shine a light on a better and more enlightened path toward goodness and humanity. The slippery slope for me is up. Yes, we are hypocrites, but in the world filled with hypocrites, we're the best damn hypocrites on the planet. Here to help us understand more, I have distinguished professor of American history, Professor Chris Lovett of Emporia State University in Kansas. Take it, Chris.
This is a very complicated subject, especially looking at the photographs of, for instance, the survivors of Andersonville or Camp Douglas or Camp Elmira, which was considered to be some of the worst northern prison camps. Now, how could the prison camp system work in the American Civil War? Well, first of all, in the Civil War, many people, particularly civilians, wanted a war of annihilation to happen against each section. In other words, they wanted to punish the South for the outbreak of the war in the first place, and the North wanted to go back and you know, the South wanted to do the exact same thing to New York, in Philadelphia, in Washington, D.C. Matter of fact, even when the Civil War was over or near its end, Confederates actually tried to burn down the city of New York. Now, first off, it's believed that the Civil War is our first really modern war. And then that's true up to a point. Because during the course of the war, you have a limited communications ability. You have very small bureaucratic establishments, particularly in Washington, D.C., in the Department of War, still run by bureaus. And in the South, it was almost ineffectual. If you look at, say, for instance, the Irish potato famine in the 1840s up to the early 1850s, nearly one third of the Irish population either perished or had to flee. And in many Irish today, particularly Tim Pat Coogan, believes that this was a form of genocide committed by the British government. When you look at it, it was an incompetence on the part of the British government because no one ever expected anything like this. You have a very small bureaucratic establishment that could handle crises like this. And the same thing happened in the American Civil War. In the Civil War, if you were a combat soldier, you could expect one of five things to happen. You could survive. You could be wounded in action. You could be killed in action. You could be taken prisoner, or you could be missing in action. Now, the military on both the Confederate side and in the federal side did provide dog tags, you know, for the troops. If you didn't have any evidence who you were or your friends could identify your body, you were just listed as virtually unknown. But if you were captured, the tendency used to be to exchange prisoners because neither side wanted to handle the prisoners. It took too much time. You had to provide logistic support for them. That was definitely out of the picture for them. So as soon as the war really broke out and this became an issue, families approached the Lincoln administration and to try to cut a deal with POWs. So in 1862, what they did was a deal was reached between the Union and the Confederacy. This was negotiated by General John Dix of the Union and General D.H. Hill of the Confederacy, who was Stonewall Jackson's brother-in-law. And what they created was a thing called the Dix Hill Cabal. And what it called for was an exchange of prisoners. There'd be two locations, one in Vicksburg, Mississippi, and the other in Northern Virginia. And what they would do is those prisoners would be exchanged, held in their respective camps, until an equal number of troops could be paroled, and then they'd be released. Now, Union soldiers didn't like this at all because they didn't want to go back into the field. So what they did was they would do what is called the French leave. In other words, they would defect. It was very difficult to get soldiers to go back in into the field after they've seen the elephant, so to speak. Matter of fact, it's very common, as Edwin said, these Union prison camps were located at the very locations of where training camps were located. Equal number of soldiers were released, then an equal number of Confederates would be released. But what happened was, in late 1862 and beginning of 1863, the Union began incorporating what they called colored troops into the U.S. military. It was called the United States Colored Troops, or Black Volunteers. Once that happened, the South really, really was upset by this. Matter of fact, the first Black soldiers that were captured were executed. Lincoln ended the parole system that was created. And this is where we get the mass destruction of human life in these camps. Now, the Confederates knew exactly what was happening. And they even sent a delegation of prisoners from Andersonville to go to Washington to negotiate. But the federal government realized, at least case of U.S. Grant and we Tecumseh to Sherman, that the Confederates were cheating. In Vicksburg, they captured 30,000 Confederate troops, give or take a few thousand. But instead of holding them, they released them back into, you know, instead of holding them in these camps, they were then released back to fight again. So you're really fighting the same soldiers twice over. So they decided to stop the exchange of all prisoners, even when they knew the horrors and the hell that these soldiers were going to endure. Now, this wasn't an issue for them. Matter of fact, when William Tecumseh Sherman did his march to the sea, he didn't send a cavalry detachment or a cavalry division. He could have used General Kirkpatrick to liberate the Union prisoners in Andersonville. He didn't do it. He didn't do it. His march to the sea, we must end the war. Now, this sounds, in many respects, almost like the discussion that was taking place in the War Department over whether they should bomb Auschwitz. What was the arguments used? The arguments were used, well, it'd be quicker to end the war, you know. And this is basically the same sort of argument that was held. Now, when all said and done, this is a horror story. This was a horror story. You didn't see any Union officials being held accountable for what happened in Elmira or Camp Douglas. But there was a reason for this. The Confederates in the Union forces faced a crisis, a manpower crisis. The Union understood that the Confederates had a limited number of bodies that could fill their ranks. So why not simply hold the prisoners as long as possible? Now, this wasn't the only real camp that happened. In 1861, because of what was occurring in the border between Kansas and Missouri, General Thomas Ewing issued General Order Number 11, rounding up all Confederate citizens, all Missourians who lived in the western counties of Missouri, driven from their homes, or imprisoning them if they were considered to be potential threats to the Union. During the course of one of these roundups in a makeshift, what would be equivalent of a wild concentration camp in western Missouri, they rounded up women, wives, mothers of any potential person they considered to be a potential bushwhacker. This building collapsed. Five women were killed. One was either the wife or mother of a fellow called William T. Anderson, who went by the name of Bloody Bill Anderson. And Bloody Bill Anderson was a Confederate guerrilla. To show you what a butcher this man was, after the death of his loved one, he decided to punish all Union troops that he got his hands on. On a train going to Sedalia, Missouri, he stopped the train, captured the prisoners, and then scalped the Union prisoners. Now we think that this ends there, right? Of course not. As Edwin talked about, you had the situation of World War I, and you had the situation of World War II. Now compare the prisoners in World War II, German prisoners of World War II, with, say, for instance, Japanese internees, Japanese attorneys were imprisoned because of their ethnicity, who they were. And even when they were imprisoned, there was even a further division among Japanese attorneys. One was between the Nisi, who were born in the United States, educated in the United States, and in the Kibai, that basically who were born in the United States, but their parents sent them back to Japan to be educated. Even the Nisi saw these Japanese Kibai as not loyal Americans, not loyal Americans. But now let's get back to the question of German POWs in comparison to Japanese internees. German prisoners of war were treated with kid gloves in the United States. And so were Italians. Many of you probably have seen The Godfather. In The Godfather Part One, you saw a case where an Italian baker went to see The Godfather and asked for a favor. He says his daughter fell in love with an Italian POW who was working in her father in his shop, and they fell in love, and he was going to be sent back to Italy at the end of the war. And he didn't want that to happen. The same thing happened in the United States. Germans were sent to camps throughout the Midwest. A large camp was in Kansas at a place called Camp Concordia, and also at Fort Riley, Kansas. And what occurred was that these people then were hired out. They worked on farms. They had to get three squares. They were taken to restaurants and dining halls. They could go hunting with American farmers. Here I have, I don't know if you could see this or not. I'm going to try to get it really close here. This is they would play checkers. If you look really close on this checker thing, what do you see? You see a swastika. See a swastika. This was done in these prison camps. They were treated, if you have any relatives that go to the University of Kansas, those prisoners basically made the camp an eel around the college campus at the University of Kansas. But African-Americans that were serving in the U.S. Armed Services, they couldn't go to the same restaurants or the same dining halls or the same facilities that the German POWs were being held at.
I think that I myself was rapt by your remarks, and I made too many notations, but I was astonished to learn that these German POWs were hired out or farmed out as what you would call interned and unfree labor. Is that not correct?
That's correct. And they were paid. They were given much like the way a prisoner would be paid, like so many cents per day, for labor, and off they would go. Now there's another thing that happens here. Prior to World War One, or even during World War One, up through say 1940, many states used what is called convict leased labor. Where basically if you were a prisoner, say for instance, Edwin, you were picked up for vagrancy. And you were picked up for vagrancy and you're arrested in Mississippi. You'd be then hired out by a company, a coal mining company. And they would pay your fine, but you would have to work until that fine was paid off. So say for instance, you owed $500. They would only pay you $1 a day. So you may be having to work for 2 years basically to earn your freedom. Stuff like that actually happened.
Yes, we are. We've done a great deal of research on these various convict labor schemes. There's too much in what you said to discuss, although I will say that the British had a similar scheme. The Nazi internees there were put onto farms and they could go help out in the villages in Scotland. I will make one further remark before I turn to our questions, and that is, I went over the diplomatic records and historic records involving German internees, diplomatic internees at the Homestead Luxury Resort in Virginia. And I can tell you that it was completely reciprocal. American diplomats, right. They had the identical menu. They were treated in the identical fashion. If someone was rude to an American, we were rude to a German, and vice versa. Let's go to our questions. We have aplenty. Here's from the watch party in the villages. Has anyone offered any reparations to any of the communities affected? Take it, Chris.
So far, they delayed the reparations to Japanese Americans. They kept playing it off year in, year out. So more and more people died before they could be paid.
Well, that's an old scheme on reparations. The Germans have done that to Jews for many, many years. As far as I know, there have been no effort to make reparations to the Germans, to the Italians. I know there was a lot moving in the way of Japanese internees. From the watch party in Newton, Massachusetts, could the Japanese camps have escalated to a state of German mistreatment, either cruelty, et cetera? Talk to us about that, Chris.
There was some violence in some of the camps. There was a breakdown between the Kibai and the Nisi. And there would be violence. There'd be riots. There'd be riots in some of the camps at Manzanar in Tule Lake. When they put these camps together, they did them rather quickly. They didn't look at sources of water for these camps. They expected the camps to be self-sufficient in agricultural products, and it was very difficult to do. And then also there was too much graft. When those camps were to be supplied with food and nutriments and sugars and flours and stuff like that, there was too many people, too many Americans skimming off the system. And this became a real problem.
Well, that sounds like the so-called Indian agents,
right,
to the American Native American reservations. Here's Randy in Detroit. Where do we see some of these pictures? Well, I can tell you that I've decided not to show these pictures at this time because they look like they're coming from Dachau,
really,
but actually coming from the American Civil War. But in the edited version that you'll see on YouTube within a month, you'll see pictures of emaciated skeletons that rivaling anything you've seen in Dachau. And you can see some of these right now because Andersonville has actually been converted to a federal park. And we will put a link to that. Eve will put a link to that in our show notes. I want to warn you, these are terrible pictures of living individuals who seem to be dead.
I want to agree with Edwin on this. If you see those pictures, you would say you were looking at Auschwitz.
That's right. Well, you would.
Yeah, they're identical.
Right.
I mean, they're totally emaciated.
I was going to open showing one. In fact, we originally had one of these pictures on the flyer, but so many people objected, including Wes in California. We share these images that we thought it was too cruel for a guy like me who deals in blood and guts to put this up. Let's go to Peter and Marcia in Los Angeles. I don't know who you guys are, but you ask the same question every week. We heard about concentration camps being planned by the Republican administration of Nixon and Agnew, Spiro Agnew. You know, there was all this talk about the black helicopters gonna round up people and put them in football stadiums. What did you hear about that in the old days?
Okay, well, basically, let's take a look at this. There's some truth to that, but not a lot of truth. Okay, back in 1950, they passed what is called the Internal Security Act, or simply known as the McCarran Act. It was not repealed until 1972. It allowed for the creation of camps to put undesirables in people considered to be an internal threat to the United States.
Wait a minute. Did you just say undesirables?
Undesirables.
And what was that, the McCarran Act?
It was called the McCarran Act.
All right, Internal Security Act. That afterwards. Go ahead. Continue.
And basically, you know, this, and they created also what is called a subversive control board too. You know, now who are these undesirables? People that were liberals, people that were fellow travelers, people that may have joined the Communist Party, or people that spoke out, maybe people that thought that, you know, segregation was wrong, you know, they could be incarcerated. Now, well, Harry Truman vetoed this measure, but because of fear of the Red Scare, and because of the fear that the Soviets just exploded an atomic bomb and the Korean War broke out and China fell to the communists, the American public was willing to buy this. And both the House and the Senate overrode President Truman's veto.
The House and Senate, was that a Republican or a Democratic Congress?
It was a Democratic Congress.
All right. And so they overrode this to establish the potentiality of picking people up. Where were these concentration camps going to be?
Oh, well, I don't know. They didn't plan the sites for them, but they authorized them if it had to come to be. Now, remember, at this time period, you know, if you were considered to be a communist, you couldn't get a passport either.
There were loyalty pledges at that time.
Yeah. Yeah, loyalty pledges. And that's really cool because in Kansas, I was working on a project on Joe McCarthy, and these people were writing to Senator Carlson saying, can't you pass a loyalty oath in Kansas? Well, they did. They had a loyalty oath in Kansas. But it dates back to the Civil War. It's still in force. If you're employed by the state of Kansas, you have to swear a loyalty oath. Not to communists and threat to the United States, but for bushwhackers crossing from Missouri. You know, but now in the 1950s, you had to swear a loyalty oath.
All right. I got a question here from Maria in San Diego. You have talked about medical concentration camps in your eugenic books, and I saw one of your lectures. Can you tell us about that? Well, we had institutions for the feeble-minded throughout New York and New Jersey and Massachusetts and Virginia.
And Kansas.
And Kansas, of course. And I believe 27 states. You could read about that in my book, War Against Weak, which has now, for some reason, got a resurgence around the world. And people could be condemned and confined to these institutions based strictly on their ancestry, on the color of their hair, on their accent. And I'm now getting a note from Robin that Kentucky had such an institution for the feeble-minded too. And these feeble-minded were the fake medical science, the fake public health of the eugenics movement. And these people were confined. And the only way they could get out, of course, was to submit to a coercive sterilization. So go ahead.
You know, also in Buck v. Virginia, that has never been repealed or at least reversed by the U.S. Supreme Court.
Yes, you're talking about Buck versus Bell.
Yeah, Buck versus Bell.
Buck versus Bell, which was the Supreme Court ruling. We had a show on all the bad rulings of the Supreme Court, a race to the bottom, which one was the worst. And Buck v. Bell was one of them. And this basically was Oliver Wendell Holmes saying three generations of imbeciles are enough. And he wanted to sterilize a mother, a daughter, and a granddaughter. And it turned out later on, as you know, that that was deemed to be genocide because genocide is one of its five counts, includes interfering with birth, including various forms of sterilization and abortion.
And also Skinner versus Oklahoma.
That's right. Skinner versus Oklahoma.
Oh, that's even worse. Three strikes and you're out. Instead of three strikes and you're out, three strikes, you're going to be castrated. You know,
that's right. And are there still castration laws on the books?
Yeah, there's still castration laws on the books. Matter of fact, you talk about it as chemical castration.
That's right. All right. We have somebody whose name I can't read in Milwaukee. How brutal were these American concentration camps? Were they just strict authoritarian, or was there brutality?
In the case of the American Civil War, gangs, in the case of Andersonville, gangs would control the camp. It wasn't so much Southerners that were doing this. It was other fellow Union prisoners. They would steal the food for the rich, the more powerful, the stronger, and let the weak suffer. If you were dying, they would deny you food, your fellow prisoners. Now, the same thing happened in American, in Korean and Red Chinese PW camps where they separated officers from enlisted men. This is why we had the code of conduct, because it was after the war was over and they listened to prisoners' testimonies. You had cases where, you'd have a sick GI and other prisoners would just simply throw them out into the cold, let them die.
We have a question here from Rachel in Manhattan. What was America's reasoning for treating Germans with kid gloves? And were the Japanese also treated with kid gloves? Take it away.
Well, the answer is no. Very few Japanese were ever taken prisoner. And when they were treated relatively decently if they didn't try to commit suicide. Japanese American internees were treated like dirt. You know, if you live in California, go to Riverside, California. They have a museum for Japanese internees. Take a look at it. You know, examine it. Read the stories. No, the Japanese were not treated, you know, with kid gloves in comparison to the German POWs who were captured. They were almost seen as kin. Now, that existed until near the war ended and when reports came back of what was actually happening in Europe. Instead of getting three hots in a cot with eggs over easy and bacon and pancakes, that stuff came to an end after 1945.
All right, here we got Troy in San Francisco. He asked a question last week as well. Tell us more about concentration camps that could be installed if the progressives and socialists take power in 2024. Well, this is a big if, but if you take eminent domain, my chief of research told me about Robert Moses in New York uprooting entire neighborhoods in New York for a so-called park. And eminent domain can be established to eliminate a synagogue, to eliminate a community. I'm just being told that Moses obliterated was called Seneca Village and was used for Central Park. So the way the progressives have now talked about eliminating suburbs, converting large homes or medium-sized homes into multifamily housing, with their ability to track people, declare people enemy of the state. We have come very close in our society today with mothers and fathers who object to their school boards being labeled domestic terrorists. Things are getting very dicey and our country is becoming more and more divided. And the media is only adding hot peppers to the stew and making sure that everyone gets burned. So there are lots of people who think that this could occur, not because they're crazy. Philip Roth wrote an amazing piece about this, and I strongly recommend seeing the movie.
The Plot Against America.
Yes, and have you seen that movie?
Yes, it's very good.
And what's interesting is, and it's got major stars in it, what's interesting is the Jews are picked up, they're impoverished by various types of pauperization. Their jobs are taken away like they were in Nazi Germany. Their property is garnished. Their savings are taken by various punishments and things of that nature. And so they say, okay, you don't have any money. We're gonna relocate you to these camps. And that's how the film ends, with the Jews being relocated. And they have one Jew in charge who is their storefront Jew, who's going along saying, oh, it's all for the good, right?
Yeah, and you know, one thing you should take a look at too is Charles Lindbergh, who's the character in this thing, he really believed this stuff. Matter of fact, his book, his wife, Anne Morrow Lindbergh, wrote a short little book called The Wave of the Future. And she said, fascism is the way of the future. Get on with it.
And Henry Ford, who inspired Adolf Hitler in so many topics, wrote, if the Jews were destroyed, would it be so bad? So yeah. I'm worried, especially when I see these mapping projects like the one coming out of Massachusetts. And now we just find out that the gun owners, different category, but same species of bad thing, have now been revealed in California. Supreme Court justices, their homes have been published. There are no more boundaries anymore. And people talk about a night of rage. Night of rage? Let me tell you something. I'm working on a show right now. Right now, my staff is developing the artwork called Kristallnacht 2.0. This is something I don't want to see. All right, we are out of time. And I want to thank my excellent guest, Professor Lovett, and the many others around the world who have participated here. I want to thank my chief of research, Eve Jones, for all the tremendous specificity she presented to help this show. I've researched a great deal of this for several forthcoming books. I'll see everyone here next week, 3 p.m. Eastern. You want to be a friend of the Edwin Black Show? Go right ahead. just visit theedwinblackshow.com/support. I need the help. My independence needs the help. Until then, head over to any Barnes & Noble in the USA or any Amazon platform in 190 countries across this planet where you can find any of my 200 book editions, such as IBM and the Holocaust, War Against the Weak, and The Far Hood. You want an autographed copy? Hit my personal website, edwinblack.com, and click books. You can get access alerts to participate live in future shows by clicking into theedwinblackshow.com. You'll see a much enhanced and produced version of this show and prior episodes by subscribing to our YouTube channel at The Edwin Black Show. Click that notification button. You will love these videos. We put new ones up each week. You can follow me at Edwin Black Book on Twitter and Facebook. And yes, ladies and gentlemen, I am zooming out.